Hello everyone. Can you hear me everywhere? Okay, awesome. So my name is Emmanuel and I recently joined Cornell faculty. And this was some joint work between these undergrad students, Jin-Chin Su and Mark Bryan. There is already a lot of research about how to present data to users in optimal fashion. However, most of my work so far focuses on visual interfaces on data visualization. But nowadays, there's many devices like Google Home, Amazon Echo, or Apple Siri, which actually transmit data to users via voice audio. And this motivates the complementary problem of data vocalization, which is about how to optimally transmit data via voice output. Now, voice output is specific for many reasons. And if you compare, for instance, reading a written text versus listening to voice output, then there are several important differences. For instance, if you read a written text, then you can easily adapt the reading speed once you encounter a complex passage in text. But the same is typically not possible in voice output, where the reading speed is fixed. Also, when reading text, then you can easily jump back with your eyes and reread the preceding passage or even the preceding headline, in case you have forgotten some context that is necessary in order to understand the current passage. Again, the same is not true for voice output, where often you would have to listen to the entire output again from the start, in case you forget something important. And then finally, even if you have a large written text, if you only care about a small part of it, then it's often possible to skim over it in order to quickly identify that specific part of the text that you're interested in. And again, that is typically not possible with voice output. We have to listen to the entire recording from beginning to end. So there's many particularities in voice output, and once we generate voice output, we have to take them into account. First of all, we have to make sure that we don't overburden the user in terms of cognitive load or in terms of memory load. So for instance, we want to generate output of a simple structure that can be understood when listening to it for the first time. Also, we want to put a restriction on the number of things that users have to keep in memory at the same time in order to understand the entire voice output. And of course, we need to consider speaking time. We want to keep voice output very concise in order not to go beyond the attention span of an average user. And that connects to the last consideration. Since we have to keep voice output very concise, it means that often we are unable to transmit precise data to the user. Instead, we have to think about how we can approximate and how we can summarize data concisely. Now, all those considerations, they lead to particular challenges when generating voice output. But they also lead to opportunities, because given that voice output always has to be very concise, it also means that it can use sophisticated generation methods which might not scale to the generation of multi-page text documents, but they are sufficiently efficient to be applied in order to generate short text for voice output. And this is why we formalize voice output as an optimization problem. And given those factors, there might be many different problem variants that one could be interested in. In this paper, we look at the first variant, where our goal is to minimize speaking time, given an input relation that we need to translate into voice output, and given constraints on the precision of the data that we need to transmit, as well as constraints on the structure of the output, which has to be simple, and we allow to constraints on the number of things that users have to keep in memory at the same time in order to understand the entire text. To make things more concrete, I'm going to show a little example. And that example is motivated by the Google Assistant tool, which also translates a structured results for web queries into voice output. It has to do that in a very concise manner. Let's say, for instance, that we want to vocalize the result of a query asking for nearby restaurants. So we have the names of restaurants and we have additional information about those restaurants that you see here. A naive way of doing that would be to simply read out one row after the other one, resulting in the output here, And that has a very simple structure, but the problem is that it takes a long time to read all the tests, more than 500 characters. Now, Google Assistant comes with a couple of guidelines about how concise voice output needs to be. And those guidelines tell you that typically you should try to keep voice output below 300 characters. And according to those standards, this text is way too long in order to be convenient for users to listen to it. However, if I look at the input relation again, I realize there are as many rows which share the same value in a certain column. And intuitively, I should be able to exploit that redundancy in order to shorten the output. And this is what we are doing here. I'm using what I will call context in the following, where I fix specific values for a subset of attributes. And that has the semantics that for all the following rows that I read out within the same so-called scope, those assignments from attributes to values still hold. And if I say, for instance, that the following restaurants have traditional American cuisine, then I can omit reading out the cuisine attribute for the following restaurants. And this is how I can shorten the text by removing redundancies. Using that, we have already reduced output banks to a little bit over 400 characters, but given our guidelines, that is still not enough. However, if I look again at the input relation, we realize that there are also rows which have values in a column that are maybe not exactly equivalent, but still very similar. And intuitively, I don't lose too much precision if I treat those similar values as interchangeable. And if I exploit that again, I can shorten the output even more, like here. Here I'm using context that assigns attributes, not to specific values, but rather to value domains. For instance, I can say that the following restaurants have an average rating between 3 and 4 stars. Then, for the following restaurants, you won't be able to tell anymore where precisely the average rating is within that range between 3 and 4. But still, if you put constraints on the size of those value domains, it means that we ensure that I get information with an acceptable precision. And now, in this simple example, I have actually reduced the number of characters to around 270. So I've cut speaking time approximately by 2, and now that would be acceptable according to Google Assistant standards. So, in general, in order to formalize the problem a bit more, we want to minimize speaking time for a given relation. We deliberately consider an output space of a very simple structure in order to make it easy to understand for the listener. And we put constraints on the size of the context, measured by the number of assignments, because this is what people need to remember in order to interpret the following rows. And we also put constraints on the size of the value domains, since that relates to precision. In the paper, we show that this problem is actually NP-hard to solve. And that means if we design corresponding algorithms, we have to make compromises. We cannot have an algorithm that is efficient and guarantees the problem optimal solution at the same time. So we need to make a compromise between computational complexity of optimization and the guarantees on the output quality that we obtain. And in the paper, we propose 3 different algorithms that realize different trade-offs in that spectrum. First of all, we show how the problem can be formalized as an integer linear programming problem. Then we can use existing solvers in order to get an optimal solution, but it takes exponential time. We also propose a two-phase algorithm that decomposes the problem into 2 easier-to-solve subproblems, and it can be tuned by parameters, creating either an exhaustive algorithm or a cheap heuristic. Finally, we also present a greedy algorithm that has polynomial runtime, but at the same time, it comes with some form of guarantees of finding perhaps not optimal, but at least near optimal solutions. So that seems intuitively very practical. In the following, I'm going to give you a quick overview of those different algorithms that we propose. You can find more details in the paper. I start with the integer linear programming approach. The high-level picture is the one that you see here. We want to transform an incompatible instance into an integer linear program, which is characterized by a set of variables, a set of linear constraints in those variables, and a linear objective function to optimize. And once we have done the transformation, We can hand that over to the intergenerative programming solver, for instance, CPLEX or Mobi, and that solver will generate an optimal solution for us. Now, the interesting part here is, of course, how do we actually represent our problem as intergenerative program? And in order to do that, we exploit that the output has to correspond to a certain template, which is here. We have a sequence of contexts followed by rows, and I also know if the interpolation has n rows, then the number of contexts that I need is also bounded by n. So this is a general template that covers the entire output space. Now I need to introduce variables that represent different instantiations of this general template. So first of all, I might use up to n contexts, but I might also use less. So first of all, I have to introduce variables representing whether one of those context slots is actually needed or used for the output or not. I also introduce variables that represent how rows are mapped to different contexts. And finally, I introduce variables describing which attributes are assigned in a context and also to which value domains they are assigned. Now those are the variables that also need constraints. First of all, I need to make sure that if there are rows assigned to a context, then the context is marked as needed. This is for consistency. We also need to ensure that each row of the input relation is assigned to at least one context. And I need to make sure that the assignment from rows to context actually represents a match in terms of attributes. If the context says, all the restaurants serve Italian cuisine, then it should only be able to assign rows which indeed represent Italian restaurants to that context. And then finally, I have to make sure that I assign attributes to value domains that are sufficiently small for precision reasons, and I have to ensure that the number of attributes which are assigned to the context, they are bounded due to memory limitations. Now this gives me an optimal solution, but sometimes it is too slow to be used at runtime. And this is why we come up with the two-phase algorithm, which decomposes the problem into two easier to solve sub-problems. In the first phase, we generate promising context candidates, and then in the second phase, we figure out which subset of those candidates we need to use, and how we assign input rows to some of those candidates. The more interesting phase is the first one, but I won't go into detail here due to time restrictions. You can find all the details in the paper. And now finally, I'm going to tell you a little bit about our greedy algorithm. The motivation for the greedy algorithm is the fact that the two-phase algorithm can be tuned to become a cheap heuristic in case you don't generate so many context candidates. But in that case, you lose all guarantees on generating near optimal solutions. The greedy algorithm improves on that by exploiting particularities of our cost functions. So in the following, I'm going to show how we can decompose data vocalization into several subproblems that each can be solved by a greedy algorithm in a near optimal manner. So we start with this holistic data vocalization problem, which is hard to solve if you want to find an optimal solution. If somebody would give you the optimal context set, then finding an optimal output would actually be trivial because you simply assign each input row to its optimal context. However, finding an optimal context set is of course hard again. Now, one thing that I could try out, instead of really finding the optimal context set, instead of that, I could really select one context after the other one. And the first question to ask when doing that is, how does the output quality relate to the optimal? It turns out, however, that the speaking time savings as a function of the set of contexts that I use has some very interesting properties. Most notably, it is a submodel of function, which intuitively means that the more context I add, the less and less it will help. So it's a diminishing returns property. And functions with that profile can be approximated quite efficiently by a greedy algorithm by Enhauser in polynomial time, and we are guaranteed to find a near optimal solution. Still, one problem remains, because in order to greedily select contexts at each step, I would have to compare all possible candidates. There can be too many of those context candidates. So What I could also do is to exploit the fact that a context basically corresponds to a set of assignments from attributes to value domains that I select. This means that I can also construct the context greedily by selecting one assignment after the other one. And in doing that, I have polynomial complexity everywhere. The only question is, how does the quality of doing that relate to the optimal quality? And analyzing the time savings and speaking time that is created by adding one more context, one more assignment to a context, turns out that this function is also submodular. Otherwise, it has slightly different properties than the previous one. In particular, it's not monotone, because if you keep adding assignments to a context, at some point the context becomes too specific and it doesn't match many rows in the input relation anymore, so then it is not useful anymore. Still, with those properties, there's other GUI algorithms that guarantee you find new optimal solutions to functions with that profile and polynomial time. And if you use one of them, then you also get a new optimal context in each step. Now, this is a very high level overview of the GUI algorithm, but you can find more details in it. In our experiments, we tested data vocalization methods in many different scenarios, reaching from restaurants over football statistics, over outputting alternative laptop models and their properties. And of course, we work with real data sets and all of those. We compare our algorithms against the leaf baseline, which simply reads out one row after the other one, and we compare them according to different metrics such as speaking time, optimization time, but also user preferences based on a user study to run Amazon to the Mechanical Turk. The experiments were executed on a standard laptop using CPLEX as integer programming solver and the IBM Watson speech generation API in order to generate voice output. Those results here concern the length of the generated speeches by different approaches in different scenarios. Here, we scale the length of the speech to the length of the speech that is generated by the leaf baseline, meaning out one row after the other one. And here, in different rows, you will see the results for different scenarios, and in different columns, you see the results for different configurations, where they vary the precision constraints, and you also vary the complexity, which in our case means you vary how many assignments you can have per context. Now, the first thing that we note here is that if I consider larger input relations with more rows, then typically I get more redundancy, which I can exploit in order to reduce speaking time more compared to the baseline. Also, if I relax precision constraints, then typically I can summarize more values, and that also means that I can reduce speaking time. Same holds if I allow slightly more complex output to be generated, then I can also summarize more efficiently. And when comparing our three different algorithms, then as expected, the integer programming algorithm performs best, but you also see that the heuristics, they perform actually very close to optimal, and so they seem to be practical to produce the problem. Finally, you might also note that the reduction that we get depends on properties of the scenario. We analyze that dependency in more detail in the paper, but on a high level, we calculate for those scenarios a measure of entropy, which basically measures a lack of redundancy in the data, and we see some correlation between that and between the time savings that we can detect. Coming to optimization time, the relative comparison between our algorithms is the inverse. Here, best algorithms are, of course, the two heuristics, the GUI algorithm, and the two-phase algorithm. Integer programming has acceptable optimization time in nearly all cases below a second, but there are a few cases where we have a couple of seconds of optimization time for the integer programming approach, so in those cases it becomes impractical to be used at runtime, and users will expect the reply immediately. For those other algorithms, there is a nice trade-off between optimization time and result quality. And finally, here you see a small extract from our user study. We basically asked crowd workers on Amazon Mechanical Turk which versions they prefer when comparing different alternatives and also why they prefer certain versions. And we correlate that with speaking time. And as you see here, it seems that speaking time is like a deduction in speaking time, is quite correlated with user preferences up to a certain point. Because once we reach a point where the concise version, which is generated by the integer programming algorithm, as well as the naive baseline, both reach up speaking times of more than 30 seconds, it just becomes too long in both cases. Users don't care. So all of that was just an extract from our experiments, but you can find more of them. Now, before I conclude, I also want to thank Hongwen-Yi from the Google Assistant team for several very helpful discussions. And in summary, in this paper, we have lookup data vocalization, which is characterized compared to other domains by the focus on voice output and relational data input. For this problem, for first variant, that problem gives, of course, different algorithms and evaluated them experimentally. Thank you very much for your attention.
Tried an alternative method, for example, things like trying to discover views over the data, and then you do, I don't know, set cover to find the views that cover your toolbox. I think that you can model your problem in such a way.
Well, the greedy algorithm already exploits the properties in a very specific way. So I don't think that you get a better solution if you transform it to another standard problem. The thing is, I mean, here there is many constraints that come into play. It's not only about trying to summarize things that are similar, but you also have many constraints in doing so. And it comes, for instance, to the size of those contexts or to the width of those intervals. So I think it is perhaps more natural to develop specialized algorithms for that. But in principle, of course, you could always transform on any part.
I wonder if the optimal framing of contexts makes sense when talking to, like, say, a blind person who's looking at restaurants. Perhaps they care more at contextualizing stuff by ratings and then perhaps, you know, by restaurant type instead of the other way around. And so at what point does, you know, optimality not make sense?
Well, so I'm not sure whether I 100% understand the question. I mean, so if you are, for instance, not interested in one specific column, then typically the query would not make a reference to that column. So I mean, this method can be applied in order to localize the result of the query. And assume that in the query you have already specified which columns you're interested in, for instance.
Right, they could be interested in the restaurant type and the ratings, but they're more interested in ratings than type.
In that case, one could configure the method in order to achieve a higher precision when outputting the rating column than when outputting other columns. Those precision constraints that we allow, you can set them separately for each of the columns. So that would give you one possibility to take into account what a user is more interested in.
Great talk and very interesting and exciting area for
thank you.
A couple of questions. So I own Google Home, and one of the things I realized is most of the times the queries issued to these whitespace interfaces are rifle shot selection queries, or they usually have very small answers like what is the capital of this country, what is the weather today, or something like that, what is the nearest restaurant about this region, or something like that. So have you thought more about, and it's usually interactive because there's context, then I ask follow-up questions and I ask more follow-up questions.
Right.
So have you looked at optimization that sort of has that interactive angle?
Right. We have not looked at interactive optimization yet. I mean, one use case that we have been looking at, as you say, there's like many queries where you get a single value response, for instance, but there's also many queries where the result in a web interface would be one of those web tables, for instance. And in those cases, currently, Google Assistant tries to select a subset of the rows and of the columns, but it is constrained by the speaking time. And in many cases, it would actually not generate voice output for those queries just because it cannot fit the data into a concise answer. And that was one of the use cases that we actually considered, where because you can basically extend the range of queries that can be answered via voice output by summarizing the results more efficiently.
Anyway, yeah, Alex also has a screen output now, if it's too large, you see.
Yes. I mean, there's different situations. I mean, in certain situations, if you have a screen, then actually you might want to directly look at the screen, or you could also consider scenarios where you want to have a good mixture between screen output and between voice output. We have not looked at that yet, but I mean, there's also many situations already, like if you are walking around in your living room, or if you are driving or walking, you basically don't want to pay attention to the screen. In those cases, you have to rely on voice output.
All right. If there are more questions, let's take them offline. Let's thank the speaker again.